Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 72 of Power Up. This is your favorite superhero show, and it's our favorite superhero show to do for you. Of course, you can catch the show on Mondays at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on youtube.com/TheLevelUpNetwork. So go there and subscribe, like the video, share them with your friends. We really appreciate when you guys do that. It means a lot to us. You can get the audio versions for free on soundcloud.com/TheLevelUpNetwork. And of course, the best way to support us is by becoming a patron at patreon.com/TheLevelUpNetwork. For just $1 or more, you get all kinds of exclusive perks and goodies. Let's begin the show. As you can see, no Greg. Greg had a family emergency, so everybody wish him the best. Keep him in your thoughts. And, you know, he'll be back next week, I'm sure. But he had a family emergency, and so I didn't want to not give you guys a show because, you know, it was kind of a last minute thing that happened, and I had already written this anyway. And frankly, I think it's a pretty good show, so I figured I would pop on and still get you guys your episode for the week. I'm sorry if it's not as good. It's just me. I don't have my sidekick to go back and forth with me and introduce that brand of silliness that we like so much. But I'm gonna do my best. It's really difficult to do one of these by yourself. It's kind of gonna be more like a vlog, I guess. But reading news, I don't know. If you've seen it before, you're familiar with what happens here. But it's a good show, and we have a lot of good news to talk about. So I did want to come on and give it to you guys, because I think you're going to enjoy it. You know what I mean? So this will be an official episode 72, and we hope Greg can return as soon as possible. Greg himself is fine, I should clear up. He is okay. He just had something going on with his family that he had to attend to. And I was going to do the book club announcement today. I'm going to wait for Greg to do that. I hope you guys are okay with that. It's going to happen. We're going to do that just like we promised. And I had some ideas about it that I wanted to talk to with Greg. So when things settle down for him, we'll come back and we'll talk about the book club some more. Maybe next week we'll make that announcement instead. So I guess without further ado, let's just get right into the news. And I'm not going to do a song. I'm not. And that's it. That's not, you know who I am. You know who I am. Story number one. Oh, shit. I forget even when it's just myself. 9 stories for you lovely sons of bitches today. Story number one begins with a small tale of Injustice 2. So WB and DC have released their final part of the Injustice 2 Shattered Alliances trailer. And man, is it good. This is a great trailer, I have to say. So this is part 5 of the series, and it focuses on Brainiac and his grandmaster plan to collect planets, eliminate the human species, and rectify the mistake of allowing Superman to live. As you can see, the trailer's rolling right now. It looks fucking awesome, dude. I was really blown away by this. I watched this at work, and I was like, oh my god, I have to watch this at home. Get into what's going on. It was such a... They're all well done. The whole Shattered Alliances trailer series has been really, really cool. But this one, man, I just thought was so great. It was so DC and, like, so DC Comics that it just completely blew me away. I'm really excited. I love the dynamic that is kind of being proposed between Batman and Superman in this because of Brainiac's arrival. And I love that Brainiac is just like this X factor that nobody was thinking about, but he's here now and they're going to have to deal with him. I think that's great. I'm excited, man. We get gameplay, depending on when you're watching this, we get a gameplay reveal of Brainiac tonight. So I'm really excited. Brainiac looks like an awesome, awesome character in the game. And I will definitely be checking him out, to say the least. I am super excited for this game. It's just... a few weeks out, I think 3 weeks now. So, yeah, it looks awesome, man. I'm so excited for this. And I'm glad this trailer series is coming to an end, because I feel like we just got just enough of this to really get excited and know what's going on. While not having given too much away about the story. So that's always a great balance that's difficult, I feel like, to strike. Oops, wrong scene. My bad, guys. That's difficult to strike within, you know, any trailer. Especially one for a superhero movie, because they get sometimes they follow the comics like so closely that it's just, it's so much information that it's hard to realize, like, in the trailer, like, what to convey and what not to, in my opinion. But that's awesome. I'm really excited for that. So if you're watching this on Monday, the gameplay reveal is tonight. It may have already happened. I don't know. But I could look, I guess. Why not? It's just you and me. It's just you and me here. You know what I mean? No. Nothing yet. But it should be coming today. So that's what's up. I am excited. Story number two. A new documentary has been announced called Batman and Bill, telling the story about once-forgotten Batman co-creator Bill Finger. And here's a synopsis for it. Sorry, that was gross. My nose is all stuffed up. Everyone thinks that Bob Kane created Batman, but that's not the whole truth. One author makes it his crusade to seek justice for Bill Finger, a struggling writer who was the key figure in creating the iconic superhero. From concept to costume to the very character we all know and love, Bruce Wayne may be Batman's secret identity, but his creator was always a true mystery. This documentary will air exclusively on Hulu May 6th, 2017. This sounds really fucking cool, man. I love that Hulu is trying to go the road of Netflix as their big initiative. That they announced this to, like, really push for exclusive content like Netflix is. That's a great idea. I like that both of them are trying to become their own networks. And stuff like this is the way to do it. People will love this. I sure am. I have a one-month Hulu trial that I haven't used. You know, I think everybody gets it if you just go to the homepage if you want to see this. So I haven't used my trial yet, but I'm going to use it just for this. And I'll watch a bunch of other stuff by there. And then who knows? Maybe I'll want Hulu by the end of it because they have so much great stuff. You know, that it's a really smart thing to do, not only to have that month-long trial, but to have exclusive content like this is a really good idea. And this sounds like a really awesome documentary. I'm really excited about this. We talked a little bit about Bill Finger when he was put into the credits, I think, of Batman vs. Superman, which was a big win for him. But I'm super excited for this documentary. I think it's gonna be great. I love a good documentary in general, you know, and I love one especially about stuff like this, like real behind the scenes stuff. And, you know, it's about Batman comics, so it's obviously catered to folks like you and me. But I'm excited, man. I do love documentaries in general, and this one is of particular interest to me, obviously. Excuse me one sec. So that's May 6th, 2017 on Hulu. Mark your calendars, guys. Go ahead and use that trial if you want to watch it. There's a lot of other stuff. I want to watch the rest of Legion, and I don't want to watch it on demand because I can only watch things on demand downstairs in my house because that's where our, like, you know, they have, like, Comcast has, like, those different level of cable boxes. And we have, like, our main boxes downstairs, and that's the one that has on demand and all that. And then up here, we just have these tiny boxes they don't have on demand. So I'm going to try out that Hulu and watch some more Legion as well. But really excited for this documentary. Story number three. Joss Whedon has alluded to possibly eyeing up an unknown actress to play Batgirl in this upcoming film. The director was asked about the matter by Variety on the red carpet of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 premiere and had this to say. I don't have my eye on anybody. I'm creating this character. I'm in a dialogue with her, and then we'll see who joins that later on. I doubt it'll be a name. I think this is somewhere where you go and find Batgirl, and then you cast her. So it doesn't seem like any of the people we were throwing in there are even going to be close in contention, or anyone big in general. It sounds like it's going to be a no-name actress, which I think is really wise. I like a good no-name. I like a good up-and-comer, a blank slate that they bring in and just, you can really see what they do, no prejudgments attached to them, no expectations attached to them. You just like, I don't know, even know who they are. And this will also really help launch someone's career. So I think Joss knows what he's doing, and I'm excited about that being an unknown person, personally. Variety asked if he was intent on casting a fresh face for the project, to which he said, I'm not against movie stars. They're great. But you need somebody who's going to be just right. In a situation like this, the name carries a lot of weight, so it's not as critical. So just what I said, pretty much, where, you know, you bring a movie star in here, there's a certain level of expectations that comes with it. any of them because you know their work, you know their reputation, you know how big they are in the industry, and you immediately start expecting things from them. So I think this is really smart, and I think he's going to really surprise us with who he chooses. Joss Whedon, man, just the perfect person for this. I really have to say, I think it is. And I also heard that he came out and he talked to Marvel before he took this, which is really, really cool. A lot of respect for that. He called Kevin Feige and was like, is this okay? Like, are you guys cool with this? And like that, he didn't have to do that because he's not working on anything with Marvel anymore. But because of their previous relationship, he did the two Avengers films. I think that's great to hear, especially after hearing a little bit about the, you know, behind the scenes kind of turmoil with Age of Ultron and how that kind of broke him. And he didn't necessarily want to make a lot of the choices that he had to make for that movie and wasn't necessarily happy with its turnout. He made a ton of money and all that, but it's not the story he wanted to tell. And it shows in the film. So I think that's really great that they still have a good relationship and that he called them and even tried to like tell them, hey, like, I'm going to the other side. Are you guys okay with this? Like, is that cool? And from what I understand, they're like, yeah, man, we want to see a Joss Whedon Batgirl movie just as much as everybody else. So do it. So I think that's really awesome. I'd love to see Joss come back down the road and do something else for Marvel. Not necessarily Avengers, but just something else. One of their female characters, you know, and get them off the ground because he writes females very well. So I think that would be great. Anyway, I am soaked for Batgirl. I can't wait. I'm excited to see who he picks and see the costume and all that. I fucking love superhero movies, in case you couldn't tell. Number four. Another new documentary has been announced, which you may have seen last night. Superheroes Decoded delves into the true beginnings of legendary superhero characters and their emergence from America's real-life events. So, for instance, take Captain America coming out of the Great Depression and how that comic book really got its start and what influenced them creating that character. Types of things like that are what will be included in this documentary. So the documentary will highlight rare access to top creators at both DC and Marvel and feature actors. I think Anthony Mackie was specifically mentioned, and directors, the Russo brothers were specifically mentioned from the MCU. And like I said, it did air last night, but the reason I'm including this news story still is because it's airing again tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on the History Channel. So if you didn't catch it last night, you still have time. If you watched this, you know, in a timely fashion and you heard this news story, you could see it tonight. I didn't get a chance to watch it, but I did know about it, and I was really excited to see it. So I'm excited to watch it tonight. I'm definitely going to check it out. I love that these types of documentaries, there's room for them on places like the History Channel. Like, that's really cool. It's really nice that this is so like widespread and accepted that they realize like audiences will care about this kind of thing. I just love behind the scenes looks at things. I always have. So I'm obsessed with special features and featurettes and things like that. I love that kind of stuff. So this is awesome. So remember, if you didn't see it tonight or you did see it last night, let me know what you liked or what you thought about it. But if you didn't catch it, it'll be on tonight, 9 p.m., so don't miss that. Gotta take a breath. So much talking when you're here by yourself, you know what I mean? Number five. This is a big one. I'm going to take a sip of my coffee before we get into this. It's a lot. There's a lot to digest here. Excuse me. Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 news breakdown. Whole bunch of it, guys. So here we go. Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 will have 5 post-credit scenes. That seems insane. I saw this announcement and I was like, what? Like, could they possibly be? Also, do we need this? Like, you guys let me know. Do you want this many post-credit scenes in movies? I'm okay with just the one, really. Even I don't mind the two where they do, like, you know, the movie's initial credits roll with the theme song and blah, blah, blah. And then, like, those are, like, the short credits. And then they give you a clip. And then when the real credits roll in at the very end of those and they do, like, another, like, fun clip for the people that stuck around past all the credits, I think that's great. I'm on board for that for sure. But 5 of them? I mean, I'll watch them, obviously. I want to know what they are, but I don't know if we really, I don't want this to become a trend, I guess is what I'm trying to say. I really don't think we need 5 post-credit scenes. That said, we don't know what they are, so maybe it's like all intertwined and it's all one scene and they just like play a part of it, roll more credits, play a part of it, roll more credits, just to interject between the credits to break up the monotony of credits, which I think is a good idea, honestly. It'll get people to stay through the credits and see the people recognition, or give the people recognition that deserve it. But that's a lot. That's a lot. I don't know. I guess we'll have to see how they do it. But I'm excited, you know, so I'm going to see what they are. I'm going to stick around for it. Next part of this is Miley Cyrus landed a secret role in the film as the voice of Mainframe after James Gunn said he was watching The Voice and he just thought she was a really cool voice and was really likable and liked her sound. And so he called Kevin Feige and was like, can we get Miley Cyrus to play Mainframe? And then Kevin Feige was like, if you think we can get her, do it. And he did. And she did. So Mainframe, as I understand it, is the voice of a planet's operating system. And I don't know that he was supposed to give that away. Or I don't know if that's common knowledge, but that's what Mainframe is. I'm assuming Egos. Which is pretty cool because that kind of just say we will see him in planet form, if that's the case. But maybe it's not. Maybe they go to a totally different world and she's the voice of a Mainframe there. I don't know. But that sounds like the most likely scenario is that Miley Cyrus is the voice. And I can see her voicing. I can see her voicing the like a computer. I can get where they got that from. I'm not a big Miley Cyrus fan, as you may or may not know. She's, I don't think, necessarily the greatest role model or singer alive. You know, nothing. That's fine. You can be yourself, Miley. It's all good. You don't have to please me, but I'm just putting my opinion out there. You know what I mean? For those who wanted it. But I think this is fine. Well, you know, it's a voice acting role. I'm glad she's not gonna be somebody like big in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I only hope that this didn't spark some kind of relationship to where she does play somebody big in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I think this needs to be the extent of her involvement in that, but you know, who knows? I'm cool with it being the voice, and let's leave it there. You know what I mean? So James Gunn also revealed via Facebook, this is probably the biggest part of the news, that he will write and direct Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3. Way to go, James. Way to stick with us. There's nothing more I like that than somebody who sees it through and sticks with us. That's what's up. And I'm super excited about this. I'm super excited about Guardians 2, man. Just a few weeks away here. A couple weeks away, actually. I think not this upcoming weekend, but the next one, right? That's fucking awesome. I can't wait. I got my tickets. I'm going that Saturday. I am very, very, very excited for this movie. I'm going to watch the first one again, too. So this is what James had to say on the matter. I needed to do it because it was what I needed to do. I have never made choices in my career based on anything other than passion and love for the stories and characters, and I didn't want to start now, meaning he didn't want to just do this for the money, which is, these quotes were a lot longer, but I shortened them because there's a lot, they were super long. So yes, I'm returning to write and direct Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3. In the end, my love for Rocket, Groot, Gamora, Star-Lord, Yondu, Mantis, Drax, and Nebula, and some of the other forthcoming heroes, that's pretty interesting, goes deeper than you guys can possibly imagine. Please, James Gunn, please, bring in Nova, please. If they are somehow able to surprise everybody with the arrival of Nova in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, not even have heard who they casted as him, and they can pull that shit off and just drop him on everybody, that would be fucking great. I don't know that they could, and I don't know that they would, but I hope he's one of the emerging heroes that they're talking about here. I am dying for Nova to be in this universe. Not one of their more famous characters, but he's a great one, and the people that know him love him. Nova is awesome, so I really hope that they get him in there. Gunn also went on to reveal that this will not necessarily be the end of his career at Marvel. And then he said about that, it will conclude the story of this iteration of the Guardians of the Galaxy and help catapult both old and new Marvel characters into the next 10 years and beyond. So they're setting up a lot with this movie, it sounds like. I will be working side by side with Kevin Feige and the gang to help design where these stories go and make sure the future of the Marvel Cosmic Universe is a special. Now, that's the most key thing, is the Marvel Cosmic Universe he mentioned specifically, which a lot of people refer to as, you know, the Nova side of things, the Guardian side of things. I just would be really surprised if James Gunn is not the one to bring in Nova. So anyway, Marvel Cosmic Universe is as special and authentic and magical as what we have created so far. I promise you, the fans, I'll do it all with integrity, love, and respect for the characters. I believe that. That James Gunn's a stand-up guy, you know? He really does have the passion for this, and he really does care, and it shows. It shows big time, I gotta say. And so that wasn't specifically, you know, meant to reflect on his continuing relationship with Marvel. I think that quote was more about Guardians 3. But he is, yeah, he said that this will not necessarily be the end of his career at Marvel, and that he may be helping oversee some other projects in the future and just be around to guide and help and have creative input in things. Give him a job. You know what I mean? Just let him work at Marvel. He's the fucking man, dude, and he knows what he's doing. He knows his characters very well at this point. So I'm excited to see what else he does for them after Guardians and what exactly they're keeping him around to do. Really cool. Marvel is such like a family. They really do seem like that at the Marvel Studios specifically. So this is awesome. I can't wait for Guardians 2, and I cannot wait to see what he does with Guardians 3 and beyond. So I'm really excited. Number 6. This will be a short one. Freeform's Cloak and Dagger has released their first trailer. The series has been ordered for 10 one-hour episodes on Freeform. Now, I saw the trailer. I don't know if you guys did. I didn't include it in here or anything like that. It was all right, I thought. It looked very like a Freeform-y. It looked like something that would be on ABC Family or CW. Like a lot of teen angst and romance, and not for me, you know. It looked well done, I will say. Like, the cinematography, you know, it looked well done. It looked really well shot. The costumes looked pretty cool from what I saw so far, and their powers looked like they had the budget to make it look good, but it doesn't look like it's going to be that great of a show from a story perspective. It looks like it's going to be for the age bracket, probably that they're exactly going for. So I won't be watching it personally, but let me know what you guys thought of the trailer, and, you know, let me know in the comments below if you will be watching this or not. I'm really curious to know. So, they have a full season ordered so far, but yeah, not for me. Speaking of something else that's not for me, number 7, Marvel and Freeform have revealed their roster for, what the hell's the show called again? The New Warriors, Jesus. And I have the photo here, and it's clockwise from the top. Zach Smith as Microbe, Dwayne Taylor as Night Thrasher, Craig Hollis as Mr. Immortal, Doreen Green as Squirrel Girl. These are the names of the heroes, by the way, not the cast. They have not casted them yet, as far as I know. Deborah Fields as Debris, and Robbie Baldwin as Speedball. It's a weird photo they included, especially when they say it's kind of clockwise from the top, but I don't know. But that's everybody there. Yeah, it is what it is. I don't know. I'm not that excited about it at all. I don't know what it's going to be like. Maybe it'll be good. Maybe it'll be bad. I don't know. We don't have a trailer or anything like that. But I'm not that interested in seeing it myself. I'll check out a trailer of it, and that'll probably be the extent of our relationship talking about it here on the show, depending on how big of a following it has, I guess, but it's not something I'm interested in. I don't think it's something Greg is interested in. I'd be really surprised if either of us gave a shit or talked about this after a trailer is released. But it seems like they're churning it out pretty fast over there at Freeform. They already had the trailer for Cloak and Dagger, so I would imagine this would not be far down the line. We will see. I'm curious to see who they cast as Squirrel Girl specifically. But other than that, yeah, I don't really care about this too much. Number 8. Fox has announced its new release schedule for their upcoming slate of films. The long-awaited New Mutants is set for April 13th, 2018. New Mutants is kind of, if you're unfamiliar, it's kind of like Teen Titans for the X-Men. It's kind of like, you know, the Young Justice team. It's that sort of thing for the X-Men. They're an offshoot. I think they were originally the X-Force, and then they were later rebranded as the New Mutants. Correct me if I'm wrong, and I'm sure you will. But I'm pretty sure that that's the way that went down. I'm not a big like X-Men guy personally, but that could have potential for sure. The highly anticipated Deadpool 2 on June 2nd, 2018. So that's awesome. They have New Mutants and then Deadpool right just a few months after that. Deadpool 2. What's there to say? Everybody's super fucking excited for Deadpool 2 and Josh Brolin as Cable. I saw them. They were doing this plastic like whatever called cast mask to get the shape of his face, probably for all the prosthetics they're gonna add for the cyborg parts of him. And then finally, Dark Phoenix on November 2nd, 2018. So three movies set in the X-Men universe for Fox in 2018. That's their own little cinematic universe they're launching over there, just all at once, 1 year. That's crazy. I mean, they've had that cinematic universe kind of now, but it's pretty crazy. That's a lot, man. Three movies in a year. These companies are really pushing them out. And if they're anything like Marvel's and can do three good movies in a year, that's awesome. That's pretty crazy. Out of these, we'll see what happens with Dark Phoenix. I did not like X-Men Apocalypse. I think Greg liked it but didn't love it. I think he said he didn't think it was that bad as everything else, as everyone said rather. But I really did not like Apocalypse at all. So Dark Phoenix, there's a good chance I won't even go see it until it comes out to rent. But if the trailer's good and I think there's more potential, you know, I have no problem swallowing my pride and going to check it out. Deadpool 2 will obviously be there day one. Can't wait for Deadpool 2. I think it's going to be awesome. I think Josh Brolin's going to nail it as Cable and Ryan Reynolds, of course, as Deadpool. I'm excited to see if they go into that like darker part of Deadpool's brain, the schizophrenic kind of a thing. New Mutants, I think, is going to have potential if they cast the right people and they set the right tone. Excuse me. There's a you know they have a problem with this when they recast in the X-Men universe, and the tone is all over the place. The timeline gets all screwed up. So they need to really start focusing this together. You know, it's time. You got to get it on track, unless you're going to reboot again and again, which I hope they don't, but it's definitely time. So look out for those three movies in 2018. And finally, our ninth and final story of the day. Captain Marvel has found its directors. Awesome. The directing duo Anna Boden and Ryan Fleck have signed on to direct the film. They are best known for 2015's Mississippi Grind, starring Ryan Reynolds. Never saw Mississippi Grind, but it's supposed to be a pretty good movie from what I hear. Pretty awesome, dude. It sounds like they're relatively new directors, I want to say. I don't know. I'm going to look them up because I haven't really heard of anything they've done before. But it's just awesome that Captain Marvel has its directors and now things will really start moving, hopefully. I know that there was some concept art, and that's about it so far. But they said, you know, subject to changing the uniform will come with depending on who they get to direct. So now that they have the directors, that'll start coming together. And I think from there, it's really gonna start taking off. So they did have a concept art though. They didn't have anything wearable yet for Brie Larson, but like I said, now with the directors, I think things will really start picking up. I'm looking. Ryan Fleck hasn't really done much, and yeah, Anna Boden hasn't really done much either. So these are two, basically, oh, they did. It's kind of a funny story, not a bad movie. It's kind of a funny story. It's not a bad movie. That was the movie with Zach Galifianakis, and he was locked inside a mental institution. There was like two kids. Emma Roberts, I think, was in that. Good movie. Well, decent movie, I'll say. But yeah, that's exciting. I'm excited that this has its director now and we can really start moving and really start getting Captain Marvel out there. I'm so excited for her introduction to the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I can't wait, man. I really can't. I think this is going to be great. And I think now, as I said, the snowball is really going to start rolling down the hill. Now that we have our directors and we have our Captain Marvel, super excited. And that is it for the news, guys. Nine stories, pretty good stories, I thought. We did have a question that I said I would answer last week. I was gonna wait for Greg, but I'm gonna answer it, and we'll see if Greg wants to give his answers when he comes back. But I'm gonna answer it since this was a short show today, obviously. Well, the question came from Rick, of course, our good buddy Rick. And we said we would do this last week. We kind of ran short on time, so I said we would do it this week. So here we go. If you didn't watch last week, this was the question. You guys have done tons of awesome lists, from the cast of characters in fighting games to ranking the MCU. How about another? Okay, Rick. I'll do it. What are your top five Marvel and DC animated shows? You can have one honorable mention. Good question and a tough question. I gave a lot of thought to this, and I actually had to write it out because I was like, fuck, I don't even know where to begin here. But I did it. Rick's order was, well, his honorable mention was Teen Titans. He says the original. Fuck Teen Titans Go. And then this was his order. Number 5, Young Justice. Number 4, Batman Beyond. Number 3, Justice League. Number 2, Spider-Man, the 94 to 98 run. You know, everybody knows the one with the Aerosmith guitar solo in the beginning. Batman, the animated series, is number 1. That is a solid list. A really solid list, I gotta say. He included a picture of 24, the show. I'm not sure why, Rick. You're a weird guy. That's a solid list. So I'll give you mine without talking about it much because, you know, it is what it is. I'll give you the same way. How about that? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So here they are. Number 5, also Young Justice. Love that show. Really like season 2 more than 1, but a great show. And keep in mind, just because, you know, these ones are lower on the list, it's tough. Like, there's a lot of superhero animated shows out there, and these are, like, some of the best, in my opinion. So, number 5, Young Justice. Number 4, X-Men, the 92 to 1997 run. You know, again, the original run. Give me a break. Fucking best. I fucking love that X-Men cartoon. That is number 4. Number 3, The Justice League, the animated series. Or, see, this is really tough because it's Justice League and Justice League Unlimited is kind of what it turned into. But so I'm including both Justice League, the animated series, and Justice League Unlimited, because it was kind of the same series. It was just the Justice League expanded into Unlimited, to like really grow the roster. So that's kind of the same show, you know? So I would include them both. But that's my number 3. Number 2, The Spectacular Spider-Man. I fucking love Spectacular Spider-Man. Can't recommend it more to anyone who hasn't seen it. It had a very short run, but check it out. It's a great Spider-Man cartoon. It's probably the best Spider-Man cartoon in my opinion. So definitely check it out. I have the box set right here on, it's just one pack, but it's awesome. You get the complete series, 4-disc collector's set. I don't know how many seasons exactly it was. But I haven't even gotten a chance to break into this yet, so I'm excited. Spectacular Spider-Man is awesome. I love the art style. I love the aesthetic. And just a great show. They did Spider-Man justice in a huge way. The way they, you know, animated him and the way they had their Peter Parker behave and just the way the fights were choreographed. It's a fucking great show. Check out Spectacular Spider-Man. And then, of course, number 1. Batman, the animated series. How could I not put it? It's set so many things in motion. Kevin Conroy, Mark Hamill. The stories were so mature for a young audience to watch. It was so adult. They appreciated, you know, their audiences. They respected their audience. It was just a truly remarkable time, I feel like, in animation where they just knocked it out of the park 10 times over and really understood what Batman was and kind of set the tone for Batman for years and years and years to come. That is everyone's Batman. Kevin Conroy is everyone's Batman. So Batman animated series is very obviously my number 1. And that's it. If you guys want to ask us a question, you can email us at powerup@thelevelupnetwork.com. Ask us anything you want, superhero or non-superhero related, and send it our way. And we will read it here live on the show. Thank you, Rick, for your question. And that does it for episode 72 of Power Up. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I'm sorry it was a little shorter. And we wish Greg and his family all the best, of course. And we hope that he'll be back here next week with us. Remember, you can subscribe to the YouTube channel. We'd really appreciate that if you do. If you like this video, make sure you click the like button. I appreciate that very much. For audio versions, go to soundcloud.com/thelevelupnetwork and become a patron to support us the best way you can. For just $1 or more, we really appreciate it. And you get all kinds of exclusive perks and goodies. Stay tuned for episode 73 next week. We should be able to announce our book club and get back to a regular show, I hope. Big credit to comingsoon.net and superherohype.com for all the superhero news. That's where I get my news. I recommend you guys check them out as well. And until next time, everybody, take care and power up.